You know, the state of mental health in this country is quietly becoming the most talked about, most talked about issue. And whether it's gun violence or troops returning from the war, whatever it happens to be, there always seems to be whispers of, well, maybe it has something to do with the mental condition. However, we don't really talk about that. And we certainly don't talk about how we treat it, not nearly as often as we should. And joining us, we have Dan Rather. Dan Rather is somebody who everybody... I would have to have a career literally spanning 60 years even to come close to the resume this man has. He's covered everything from the White House to Vietnam, Afghanistan, Persian Gulf, the assassination of JFK. And he joins us to talk about this because he has a special report that you need to watch and you need to share. Mr. Rather, welcome to the show. How are you doing, sir?
I'm doing great. Thank you so much for having me on today.
Well, thank you for joining us. Now, you have a show, Dan Rather Reports. It's on Axis, correct?
Axis TV, which is on, it's available on all satellite channels and on a lot of cable channels. It's a satellite and cable television, one-hour weekly program which specializes in investigative reports.
Well, I think investigative reporting is something we need to get back to. In the world that's full of, you know, how many links can I click or, you know, give me the news in one paragraph, the work that investigative journalists continue to do is where the real news comes from. And that's really why I'm having you on today, because what you've exposed in regards to the treating of and handling of the mental patients in this country is absolutely alarming. Can you tell us your next report, a one-way ticket to nowhere?
Well, yes. This started with the Sacramento Bee newspaper profiled some time ago. They should have won a Pulitzer Prize for it, in my opinion, a case in which Las Vegas, Nevada, had taken someone with a mental disorder, bought him a one-way ticket to San Francisco, and said, when you get to San Francisco, call 911. It was a clear case of dumping a mental patient on another jurisdiction. When I started looking into this, I thought it was, you know, this was a rarity. It turns out that many cities and towns around the country, not just Las Vegas, do this. They dump their people with mental disorders on buses and just send them to some of the jurisdiction. In Las Vegas, they may have done this with 1,600 people. So far as I know, nobody on national television has been dealing with this, so we started our investigation, and it's really shocking how often this happens. It's indicative of the fact, and it is a fact, that we really don't have a way, a system for taking care of people with mental disorders in this country. About the only time we pay attention to it is, as you mentioned, we have a school shooting or something violent, and somebody says, well, gosh, the perpetrator may have had mental disorders. Here are the facts. 2 to 6% of the American population is estimated to have serious mental disorders, schizophrenia, bipolarism, that kind of thing. But another 20% of the population has mental disorders, not as serious, but things like eating disorders, depression, PTSD. And we don't have a system for treating these people. As a consequence, our jails, the police are left to deal with them in many cases. The jails get overfilled. Yeah. With people with mental disorders. That has almost doubled our population in prison with people with mental disorders. Our emergency rooms are overwhelmed with it, and we've just not developed a system for dealing with mental disorders. This is a national crisis. Crisis is an overworked word in our vocabulary, in my opinion, but this is a national crisis and something that people are slowly becoming aware of.
Well, and you know, the situation is so alarming. I had no clue that hospitals were dumping. I knew that hospital traffic increased. But to think that a hospital's literally saying, hey, we need the bed space, here's a ticket, get on a Greyhound, let somebody else deal with you, that's just amplifying the problem, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely. And it's not the American way. I don't know of any decent-intending American that would approve of that. Emphasize again, while Las Vegas has become sort of a showplace for us, a lot of places around the country are quietly doing this.
Well, They are, and it's really sad. We have a VA hospital here locally that's doing a similar practice, and I thought people would cover it, which is why, again, there's such a huge difference between investigative journalism and just reporting. And tell us a little bit more about the premise behind your show, because it's digging into the story that brings to light the facts like this, isn't it?
Well, as I don't like to do investigative reports and say, here's a problem, and not at least explore the possibility of solutions. And in a nutshell, Amen. This is a situation. In the late 1950s and 60s, we decided as a nation, as a people, that these huge psychiatric hospitals were nightmares, and indeed they were. And we made the right decision, which was to close them. What we said we were going to do was, instead of big psychiatric hospitals, have local community centers where people could go get diagnosed, get medication. Medication, in many cases, will steady the problem. But we closed the psychiatric hospitals. We never moved to the second step of getting these community centers where people could go to get treated. And as a consequence, we now find ourselves here in the early stages of the 21st century with this problem is collapsing, as I say, our jails, our emergency rooms, our hospitals. And there is a solution. It does cost money, but it doesn't cost nearly as much as what we're spending now on overwhelmed jails, prison systems, and emergency rooms.
Well, and, you know, to amplify that just a little bit further, you have people who suffer from these conditions and they need treatment. Usually these are the same people who have a hard time holding down a job. And when you go to the local, you know, mental health facility, they're so overburdened because there's so few anyway, that the people who can't maintain steady income can't afford any sort of help outside the community service, so they're really left in limbo.
Exactly. And this is the case. Homeless people don't vote. And therefore, the kind of people you're describing, not every person with a mental disorder fits that problem. But in case of homeless people, many of whom are veterans, by the way, they don't vote. And therefore, whether the politicians at state and local level, or for that matter, national level, are Republican or Democrat, because this is a constituency that doesn't vote, the problem doesn't get any attention. We only give it attention, as I say, when there's some school shooting or violence, and it gets in the headlines for a few days and then disappears.
Well, and the fact that suicide now outranks car accidents as a leading cause of death should be a red flag to everybody.
Absolutely. And we do know that suicides are on the increase, and overwhelmingly a high percentage of suicides, they're rooted in some form of mental disorder. Some cases very serious mental disorders, but in other cases not so serious. And here's the point that I think really needs to be made. In many, many cases, I would say in most cases, medical experience shows if people get the right diagnosis, they get the right treatment, they get the right medications, they can reach the point where they hold down a job, go back to school, they can live normal lives. But there's no system, no widespread system now to give people that availability, which is the reason the suicide rate is...
Mr. Rather, hold on one second. We're up against a break. I want to know what you found out happened to that hospital in Nevada. Can you stick around for one more segment, sir?
Surely.
Perfect. Then we'll be back with Dan Rather right after this. We are talking to legendary journalist Dan Rather. He has a series coming out, Dan Rather Presents. It's part of his ongoing reporting, Dan Rather Reports, on Access TV. And it's talking about the state of mental health. And it's so alarming. I mean, this report, you have to see it. It airs tomorrow, May 6th, Tuesday. It airs tomorrow. A one-way ticket to nowhere, a hospital in Nevada, 1,600 patients dumped, essentially just given a ticket saying, hey, you know what, go someplace else, get off our doorsteps. Mr. Rather, what happened to this hospital? I mean, obviously you said the Sacramento Bee broke the story. You're picking up on it on a national level. They obviously had to respond. What's been the outcome since people were made aware of this?
Well, the hospital, the basic... shipping out this dumping of patients was done by a hospital called Rawson Neal, which was a state and local hospital in Las Vegas. their leadership, first of all, the state government, which was involved in financing the hospital, once the story was exposed of what they were doing, this dumping, and I emphasize they're not the only people in the country doing it. A lot of people have been doing it. But they sent out so many people, they got caught at it. They were in danger of losing their accreditation from both the federal government and from medical institutions, so they had to deal with it. They say that they now have cleaned up the situation. They say that they no longer do this, that they do send people back home, but they don't dump patients. And by the way, they don't like the phrase dump patients, but in fact, that's what they were doing. So one, they got caught. They fired some people. They transferred some people. They changed their systems. And they now are on the verge of having their accreditation reconfirmed, if you will. As I say, they were in danger of losing it. Our investigation showed that they have made a good faith effort to clean up what was obviously a very bad situation. They make the following arguments. Number one, they said, look, we went to this in desperation, this dumping of the patients, because we found we couldn't handle it. We had to close our emergency rooms. We had so many people with mental disorders. We didn't have hospital beds, so in desperation, in effect, we just shipped them out to other people. Also, one other point, they say that in some cases, for example, some places in Southern California shipped their mentally disorderly people to Las Vegas. All of this speaks to what a crisis this is and why something has to give. We can't keep on going the way we're going.
Well, exactly. I mean, to say, you know, well, another hospital has done it, I mean, that's kind of like Al Capone blaming Jimmy the Nose or something. Well, he did it, so I'm going to do it, too. Let's go to Ivan in Illinois, who has a question for mental health. Welcome to the show, sir. What say you?
I say, wonderful having Dan Rather on. What a superb human being for the U.S. citizenry. I know the fight that he's had a lot of people do. Now, this was a 1-2 punch. Mr. Rather, I think you're very well aware of it. Back in the early 80s, we know who was in. He started closing. He closed down all the mental hospitals, the sanitariums, in the name of money. What it exactly consisted of was privatizing and giving it over to the privateers, the wolves, and took it away from the public funding. And they knew, in lieu of taking psychotropic drugs and letting these people out of these hospitals and everything, what was going to happen, they would go right in the arms of the private prisons where they would just make tons of money on these people's lives. And so many people's lives, were familiar with some friends that had their son out and that went through all kinds of trouble and everything, was doing well in the hospital. I suppose has happened to many people. And
it
so
has, I'm sure.
It was the Reagan administration. They knew exactly what they were doing, and we're paying the price for it, and our poor people that's got these problems and everything. Dan Rather, I'm so blessed to be able to talk with you. I've seen you for many years, and thank you for your service, sir.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate that. I'm deeply moved by that, and I deeply appreciate it. And much of what you say is, of course, true. That there wasn't a major effort in the 1980s to turn much of treatment of mental disorders over to private sector, which didn't work. I will say in fairness that this is a problem that neither Republicans nor Democrats nor self-styled independents, we've lacked political leadership on this question in both parties and all parties since the late 50s and early 1960s. The solution is to go to a system of community centers where people can get diagnosed, they can get treated, they can get on medications. This won't solve everybody's problem, but it will give us a system that's humane. We refuse to go to that system, and in the meantime, we spend more money on keeping people in jail and prison and trying to deal with the overload of emergency rooms than it would cost us to go to this system of community centers.
And you know, there seems to be such a misunderstanding, even from the medical side, sir, that you know a lot of doctors don't understand the complexity of mental disorders. And even, not to play political sides, but even when you had the writing of what's now called Obamacare or the Affordable Care Act, both sides kind of admit, you know what, yeah, we kind of dropped the ball when it came to the mental health side of this too. So now they're trying to figure out how to fix that. So this isn't really necessarily political in its treatment, even though political actions may have exacerbated the situation, correct?
Well, that's a very good point. I just want to underscore that, you know, there's a tendency for Democrats to blame Republicans, Republicans to blame Democrats. There's plenty of justifiable blame to go around on all counts. And you're quite right about the Affordable Care Act, which some people call Obamacare, that while it made an effort to reform the system for some forms of health care, there's not much in it that will do very much for this problem of people with mental disorders. And again, I want to emphasize that the best available estimates are that 2-6% of the American population has serious mental disorders, such as schizophrenia and bipolarism, but another 20% have mental disorders that are not deathly, lethally serious, but nonetheless need to be treated. And there's no other area of health in which we ignore it as much as we do mental disorders.
Well, and you know, and I want to remind people again, tomorrow, Tuesday, May 6th, that's when this airs, a one-way ticket to nowhere. Let's just real quickly, because I have you less than 2 minutes, let's talk about Dan Rather reports in general. I mean, you made this transition to not an alternative, but a not mainstream network either. Do you find that it gives you a little bit more freedom to kind of dig into stories you want to dig into?
It does, and I'm really lucky and blessed at this stage of my career to have this work. I have total, complete, absolute editorial and creative control, which virtually no journalist has. Mark Cuban, who owns a network, gave that to me. And look, we don't have as wide a distribution, wide a viewership as we'd like, but it's growing. But this kind of investigative reporting, somebody's got to do it. I wish more people could do it, but I consider myself lucky to be able to do it.
No, you just brought up something extremely interesting that, you know, most journalists don't have the ability to kind of control their own content. In light of how journalism has changed over your career, do you think that control is getting worse or better, or has it just kind of been the same since the dawn of journalism?
No, it's getting much worse, and the reason is because in terms of true national distribution, only about 4 to 6 big international corporations now control the national distribution of news. And unfortunately, they're in bed with big government, whether the big government's in charge at any given time by Republicans or Democrats. And they have so much business to do in Washington, they don't want hard-edged investigative reporting, which is one reason you have so little of it.
So true. Well, now that you have your own horse by the reins, I'm excited to see what you're coming up with and putting out. And this one-way ticket to nowhere is just absolutely amazing. I'm telling people, you have to watch this. Again, Tuesday, May 6th. What else is coming down the pipe real quickly?
Well, we've done an investigative report. We had someone on the air. We'll come back to it, of how marijuana, however you feel about marijuana, with the easing of marijuana laws, big-time international crime syndicates have started raising marijuana in this country, and they do such things as use illegal pesticides, which raises the question for people who are getting marijuana.
Well, Dan Rather, I got to let you go. I'm going to have you back. I appreciate you so much. We'll be back right after this.